And who shall reign forever. Lord, we thank you for all that you do in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for loving us. We thank you, Lord, for caring for us. We thank you for taking, oh God Almighty, that keen interest of every detail of our lives. We thank you for everything, Lord. even the healings that are taking place in this place, Lord.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord.
I want to thank you.
Yes,
and I want to give you all the glory. And thank you for your word that is coming this morning. Speak to us in your own special way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. We may be seated in the presence of God. You know, just being in the presence of God is an exciting thing because you don't just want to stop. Amen. You may be seated, Tim. So wonderful. Hallelujah. How many of you are excited to be here? I'm excited. But I've decided to hide my excitement today because... Now, all of you are ready to listen to what I'm about to say, right?
Yes.
Oh, I've even forgotten what I wanted to say. Okay. Yeah, so there are a few announcements that you must know. This is CFGM, Simply Christian Faith Global Ministries. We love people. We love you. We love our online viewers right now. We just pray that even as we hear the word of God, you'll be able to be blessed together with us. And we want to welcome those of you that are visiting us, maybe for the first time. God bless you. So Christian Faith Global Ministries is meets in this place, Beaumont Hills, every Sunday from 10 to 11. But of course, we come earlier than that because there are other things that we do. Amen.
Amen.
And we also have a faith time every Wednesday, which is 7:30. Coming this Wednesday, I encourage you to be part of it.
Amen.
If you can't manage to come, you can join us via Zoom. Amen. 7:30. If you want to come in person, that's at 16 Kekwa Avenue, and that's in Castle Hill. Amen.
Amen.
So we encourage you to come and be a part of us.
Yes.
So that we can grow together in the Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
So we're going to go straight to the Word of God this morning, and we are going to Psalms 19. Praise Jesus. And I'll read Psalms chapter 19, and we'll read from verse 1 to verse 4. And the Bible reads, "The heavens are telling of the glory of God, and the expanse of heaven is declaring the work of his hands. Day after day pours forth speech, and night after night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there spoken words from the stars." Do you think about that? "Their voice is not heard, yet their voice in quiet evidence has gone out through all the earth. Their words to the end of the world." Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning.
Amen.
Speak to your people.
Jesus.
Speak to me.
Yes.
And speak through me in Jesus' name. Let your word of Father God be able to change and transform our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now when we look at what God has created, what is apparent to our eyes, I believe we also can declare, just exactly as David did. Hallelujah.
Yes.
How many of you are, just take a minute and begin to look at what God has done. Have you ever come out of your house at night? Like there's an eclipse, stars, the moon, and everything that you see up there in the sky. Everything that is in the heavens, everything that is in the earth, in existence. I mean, what can stop you from declaring the glory of God? There are times when people sometimes will make a trip and visit those beautiful places. And I love watching that, because sometimes when I'm just home, I'll put, 10 beautiful places in Italy. Or 10 beautiful places in Zambia. 10 beautiful places in Zimbabwe. 10 beautiful places in Chile. 10 beautiful places in Brazil, in Mexico, in Romania, and all those countries. And have you realized that each and every country has some beautiful places that when you look at them, you're like, what? I was watching Sri Lanka last Sunday. We were watching with Victor and Andrew. And then we went on to watch beautiful places in Sierra Leone as well. You know, you can find that each and every country has some beautiful places that you can look at. But when you begin to think about these beautiful places, you are able to say, indeed, all these beautiful things speak about the glory of God. Hallelujah. Now, we're just talking about watching that on video, but some of you and some of us have actually been to such places before, amen? Anybody been to such a beautiful place before in your life? Like when you looked at it, you were like, wow. What came to your mind the moment you saw that beautiful place? What was it that ran through your mind? Looking at David's words, we can see that he was dealing with God's beauty. God's perfections, which he has displayed for himself, for his own glory. When you look at all that, you're able to say, this is what the Lord has done. So the beauty about God can not only be seen in us, but also in the things that he has created. Let's not even talk about man and woman, because there is the real deal. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. I can see the way Gabriel is looking at the wife, and I can say it's the real deal right there. God is so wonderful. Amen. How that he fashions a woman. Let's leave that on the other side. So when David gazed to the skies and everything that is on the earth, he saw God's grandeur plainly. And as a writer, as a psalmist, he begins to say, the skies and everything up there tell us the glory of God and its beauty. So every time we live on earth, this is exactly what happens. We are confronted with God's beauty. Everything around us, it's us people that mess up what God has created. But when we look at everything that God has created around us, we begin to see the things that God has done as beautiful. In fact, the good news is, when he created the heavens and earth, the Bible says he saw that everything that he had created was good. He saw that it was good. Come on, somebody. Is that not good news? If he saw that it was good, then it was good indeed. And when I look at it, I should see the beauty of God. Amen. In everything that he has done. We are surrounded by God's beauty. You know, I remember something as regards to technology. I was talking to somebody another day and I said, look, when you look at what's happening in the world today, there are a lot of things that are coming up, and phones, smartphones you call them, which can actually even talk to you, talk back to you actually. You know, it can, you know these things like Alexa, and Alexa talks back. Alexa talking back to you. Right? And all this technology. Now, when we look at the technology, we are like, oh, wow, this is good. And the problem is we look at the people who do all those things. Some of them are atheists and some of them don't even go to church. Right? But then we don't see the hand of God in all those things. But do you realize that everything that they use belongs to God? The mind, the ideas, everything, the materials and everything that they use to make these smartphones are actually things that God himself created, hallelujah. And he gave these things to us. In other words, God is the architect of everything that happens. Only it's entirely up to man to use what God has given him for the right purpose or for the wrong purpose. So knowing the purpose of a thing is very important. So therefore we have David saying these words, and he says, the heavens declare the glory of God. How does the heavens declare God's glory? And that's a big question right there. So we're going to look at this morning, and I believe, you know, we will be blessed with God's word, and I'll try as much to bring it out slowly to all of you this morning. Amen. I know I'm not a person who loves to speak slowly, but I'll try today. And if I can't, I'll go back to default. Hallelujah. All right. Now, we look at this happening, and David is talking about the heavens declaring the glory of God. And my question was, how does this happen? As I was looking at this word, you know, I was meditating on this word, and I was looking at this word, and I was saying, what is it that God want to teach me from this? Why did it take David to write this in the word of God? What's so important about this verse? Why should we read about it? Why should we preach about it? Why can't we just look at it and move on without even saying anything about it? But this is the point. God's existence, majesty, power, creative brilliance is revealed in creation. Hallelujah. It's in that creation that you begin to see the kind of God we say. And that's why when we say, what a mighty God we save, it's because of what we have seen him do before. And what gives us the hope and the confidence that my future is secure. What makes me know that I am safe in the hands of my Father is what he has already done for me before and after Jesus. And that's why we looked at Jesus last time, and we came to discover that Jesus said it is finished, because he was simply saying, I have finished the work for you, and all you gotta do is walk in my already finished work of victory. And I remember way back having spoken to someone who was going through some difficult situation, and I said, look, and I want to tell you this, never forget this. If God took care of you all this time, God is not going to fail you now, and God is not going to fail you in the future. Because if he did it, then he's going to do it again. If he came through for you last time, he's ready to do it again for you, because you are his son or daughter. He's ready to do it again and again and again for the people that he loves. He loves you. He cares for you. He is mindful of you. And David said, who is man that thou art mindful of him? He cares for you and he loves you and is ready to go all the way. So the heavens proclaim the existence of God. And as well as his mighty, his creative brilliance, his goodness, and every other things that are in that package, the mercy of God, the kindness of God, the grace of God, and everything that is in there. And in verse 2, the Bible says, day after day, they pour forth speech and night after night they reveal knowledge. And when I was meditating on this one, I was inspired to see how this is done. Because if you look at what he's saying, Father, he says they don't speak. Right? But how come they are still bringing this to us? Because he writes before, he says they pour speech to us. Then he goes and says they don't speak. Hallelujah. So when I was looking at this, I saw something right there. You know, David is talking about the heavens, but I also have to add something to this, the whole creation. And when I was looking at this, I began to look at how sometimes we look at medicine in hospital and everything that has been, made by or manufactured by people. And I believe most of us have used Panadol before, right? Brufen. And many other medicines, right? Mm-hmm. It's good. You can have that faith where you pray, you are healed right there. God heals instantly. And there are times also God, you can go to the hospital and get your healing, right? But then what do we think? When we are prayed and healed instantly, we see God. When we go to the hospital and we're healed through drugs, we don't see God. Is it not how we see things? Oh, you just have to have faith, you know. Okay, let's pray. You are healed. Jesus healed you. Somebody comes from the hospital, drank some drugs. Who healed him? Not the drugs, not Jesus. Who made them make those things? Who worked out the plan? In fact, you know, sometimes the way we think about life is simply saying we don't need doctors. And I tell you, in this church, we have doctors. And we have them, and they are good people. They do the work of ministry. And this is God's plan for humanity. That's how we get jobs, because this is all the plan of God. And God knew we will need every one of us in this place. We don't need to think the other way, because that's how we lock ourselves up and don't see the bigger picture, and we fail to see what God is doing. Hallelujah. So I was led to see how trees and their roots have been utilized in human history, actually medicinally throughout, to bring healing to the lives of people. Trees and roots. And they, our parents way back, here they would make drugs out of them. Our parents would just say, mix that, and it works. But who created the trees? God. Hallelujah. And it's working. And it's working for all of us. You know? So while sometimes we may focus on healing through prayer, God is also using other ways to reach out unto us. God is using trees. God is using everything else to reach out unto you and show you that I love you and show you that I exist. I am the creator. I have the power over all things. And that's why he himself, Jesus, went to the fig tree, because he knew the purpose of the fig tree. Hallelujah. And when he got there, he wanted some food, but the fig tree would not give him the food, and he cursed it, because when he created whatever he created, he put purpose to them. There is nothing that has been created by God without purpose. And everything that has been created by God is simply to reveal God's glory. Hallelujah. When we use it, we need to see God's glory in it. So sometimes when I take the medicine, I say, thank God for the doctors and thank God for the pharmacists, because you created them and the drugs and everything that they do, the ideas that they have for your glory. Hallelujah. Yes. Praise Jesus. We need you and we need everybody else, because God knew one day we will need your service. Praise Jesus. Amen. Amen. Are we ready for this?
Yes.
So those trees provide healing. Those trees provide a lot of things that we need to our own personal lives for our benefits, Food, for instance. Now, if I come to food, there's a problem right there, right? Because a lot of people are saying, I've stopped eating this, I've stopped eating that. But it was for our divine healthy, for our healthy. Mm-hmm. God knew we need carbohydrates. God, all these speak the glory of God. But of course, we need to learn how to use them and not abuse them. Praise Jesus. So God provided us with everything in this world for our benefit, allowing us to understand and know that it does exist. So through everything that God has created, it does it so that you and me can see that it does exist, that it loves me. Mm-hmm. Do you see the love of God in what you have in your life? Maybe some of us don't see that. When I see at what I have, I see the love of God in it. Hallelujah. You need to see God's love. You need to see that God desires an intimate relationship with you. Whatever he created is simply making those things make you realize that there is someone who created these things, and I need to know the creator. Now, the world is so funny because the world would want to know the creator of the content on Reels and Instagram, but they don't want to know the creator of the heavens and earth. That's tough. Oh, wow, this is a very nice tweet. This is a very nice, who did this? Who said these words? Who is this? But when we talk about the creation, the heavens and the earth and everything that is in the heavens and the earth, we do not have the same passion to get to know him the same way we have the passion to get to know those guys on Facebook, Instagram, and those who, you know, make songs and stuff like that. But God wanted us to know him. Whatever God created speaks to us through what we benefit from it. When we benefit something from it, we need to understand that there is someone behind this thing. There is someone who created this thing. There is someone who put this thing to exist in the world. Hallelujah. So these communicate to us and impart wisdom on the majesty, intelligence, and creative brilliance of God. Lord, I now know that you are wise. God, I now know that you are creative. God, I now know that you have the power. God, I now know that you love me. God, I now know that indeed you are the Alpha and the Omega. And David had these words to say in Psalms 23, verse 3. He says, refresh my soul. He refreshes my soul when I am beside the quiet waters. David realizes that even going through near to the river on that nice green grass and lie down there and begin to feel that, you know, that peace and begin to feel good, it's all because of the love of God. Amen. Do we see it that way when it's very hot here in Australia?
Yes.
When it's very hot and all of you are saying, let's go to the beach. And we are rushing to go out of church because we want to go to the beach, but we don't even realize it that the waters we are rushing to, the one we are running away from, created them. Before the service ends, or say, I'm going to, you know, Bondi Beach. He created Bondi Beach so that when you lie there, you can feel God and say, this is God's doing. Hallelujah. Therefore, the church must arise and preach the gospel. Listen to this. If the skies, if the heavens can declare the glory of God, then you and I can declare the glory of God. Amen. You and I must preach the gospel. According to the command of Jesus in Matthew 28, 19, 20, the Bible says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey anything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. We are called to reveal God's majesty, God's power, God's grace, God's love, God's mercy, God's creative brilliance. When we live on earth, just the same way the heavens are declaring the glory of God. When you wake up in the morning, tell yourself, my duty today is to reveal God's glory wherever I go. Hallelujah. Whoever I meet, I need to reveal God's glory. Whoever I talk to, I need to take the gospel of Jesus Christ. I need to show them love. I need to tell them that He loves you. He cares for you. He is there for you. Don't give up. Don't give up. Then you will see that guy who's about to commit suicide giving up on committing suicide. That's the day you will see that person who is saying it is over. That's when his passion will be rekindled. And tell himself that it's not yet over until he says it is over. He is in control. Hallelujah. You need to declare the glory of God.
Amen. Yes.
Divine acclaim. The heavens elevate God with praise, honor, and exhortation. That's the duty, to tell the people and say, you know what? We are here to give praise to God. We are here to give praise to God. They praise, they honor, they exalt God. There's a guy, and maybe some of you have met him, maybe some of you have sung with him somewhere, because I know somebody sung with this person here. And maybe some of you have heard the song, but he wrote a song which is titled, So Will I. So Will I. How many of you have heard the song, So Will I? You know, he's talking about a lot of things in there. Now, what makes this song very unique is the fact that it reflects on the incredible creation of the universe. You remember, right? For those of you that have heard that song, it's about the stars, cosmos, and everything else that God has created. So this song talks about God's limitless love and strength. I'm just trying to make it shortcut in my own way. Hallelujah. So I'm doing a review of the song. The song's amazing words and powerful music evoke a profound sense of amazement. But not only that, it also sends us into a place to worship God. How many of you have heard it and you've just sat, you like, it does that. If the stars were, even when you don't know the words, right? So nice a song. So good, so nice. You are hearing it and you're saying, yes, this is it. You know, he explores the themes of creation, redemption, and God's unconditional nature of love, that he loves us unconditionally. The song continues to encourage us to surrender to God and adore him and worship him. It makes us begin to realize how powerful he is. How that is, you know, he is a God full of wisdom. He is a God who is concerned about perfection and beauty. That's a very powerful song. And I want to quote something from that song, because I want to use this for all of you this morning to see something that I want to talk about. There is a part where he says, if the stars were made to worship, so will I. So he's saying, the stars, if they were made to worship you, then what should I do? I should also worship you. Now that's helping us today to begin to see how that we should take our worship higher. We're not just here to lead people. We're here to be in the presence of God. and experience the presence of God and begin to feel that period as we worship God, that there is something that is going on. We are not just spectators in here. Even when these people also are singing here, all of us back there, we are not spectators. We are called to be in a place of worship, in that direct, intimate relationship with God. So if the stars were made to worship, our duty is to join with the stars, to join anybody else, to join with the angels, to say, you know what? My job. If I don't worship any other thing, I got something that I need to worship, and that's Jesus. If the stars were meant to worship you, I have chosen to worship you. Sometimes I go crazy, but I'm not part of the band, so my craziness is not seen by anybody. There are times I'm seated there and I'm just thinking, Brother Dabson, can you add another tune right there? And just say, and I'm not there. It's not me. It's just in me. It's not in him. Hallelujah. And I'm looking at Caris and I am saying, why don't you even put ding, 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 ding. Then I'm like, it's just me right here. And I'm saying, Brother G, why don't you? And I'm just saying, it's just me here. I am crazy right there. But can we be crazy for Jesus?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And it says, if the mountains bow in reverence, so will I. If the mountains will bow before God, when is this church going to learn to bow before Jesus? When are we going to learn to bow before him? Is it that hard? Are we waiting until we meet him and that's when we bow? Are we waiting when he comes and that's when we fall prostrate in the presence of God? They did it so we can do it. Are we waiting? Or do we want to do it now? Hallelujah.
Amen.
And it says, if the oceans roar at your magnificence, so will I. It is Jesus who said these words. And can I have courage back? He said these words. He said, and I want to quote from his word. He says, I tell you, if these people keep silent, if in this church we're not going to worship God, if in this church we're not going to raise our hands to give him the glory, if in this church we're not going to bow down before him, he said, listen and listen good. This is what I'm about to do. He said, I will raise the stones. If you keep silent, the stones will cry out in praise, because God wants you and me to worship him. God wants you and me to give him thanks. God wants you and me to praise him. And he says, get ready, because I have done that already. Get ready, because I'm raising people who will worship me in spirit and in truth. People who will sing praises to me. And I am doing it, and nobody will stop me. But if you're not gonna do it, I am going to raise the stones to do it for me. And I understood why they give worship. They don't speak, but they give worship in that silence. And it's your duty, you and me. And then it says finally, divine service. Divine service. In this place we find divine service. Creation revealing God's glory is divine service. It's what the creation of God has been created to do, to preach and to save him and to worship him. And he says, because I have done this to the creation, man is no exception. Man should do the same. If the stars were made to worship, man should worship God. Man and woman should learn to lift up Jesus. So when the stars, when the plants, when everything is giving things to humanity, whatever they are providing, you know, the sun provides us with light, the rivers with the waters, the trees with those drugs I was talking about, and many other things and fruits, they are serving God. And the purpose is to reveal God's glory. Hallelujah. So one of the fundamental purposes of creation is to demonstrate God's magnificence, majesty, beauty, and many other things. And in this view, the universe itself and its diversity, its intricacy, and order are interpreted as an expression of divine traits, glory, and everything else to inspire you and me to worship God. So that you and me can stand up and worship God. Lift up Jesus.
Amen.
In conclusion, three things you can go with back home. Number one is that we are called to preach the gospel and make God known among all nations in the same way creation does. Number two is that we are called to worship and praise and give Him thanks in the same way creation does. Number three, we are called to save God in the same way creation does. God bless you. Shalom, shalom.
Amen. Come on, church, let's just stand together and worship God.
All my life you have been faithful. My God, you have been. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Watching on screens, or you are in the house and you're saying, I have never even had a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, we would like to encourage you that today is your day to start. You know, our worship starts with having a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It starts from committing our lives and our bodies unto Him. Amen. So we would like to just give you this opportunity to pray with us. And if that's you, you would like to dedicate your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, we would like to pray with you. So I'm going to pray a prayer. You repeat after me and the church will join in. This is your opportunity to accept the Lord Jesus Christ, to follow the Lord Jesus Christ so that you may worship the Lord. Amen. So come on, if that's you, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you that you created me to worship you. And today, Lord, I turn my life to you. I ask you to come into my life, to be my Lord, to be my Savior. I want to live for you and to glorify you. Thank you for your forgiveness and mercy. Thank you that I'm accepted in your family. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank you so much. If you prayed that prayer for the very first time or you recommitted your life to the Lord, we're just so grateful you did that. And we would like to know about it. So feel free to jump on our website or drop us a note to let us know that you made this decision today and you have a brand new life. We're just so, so excited about that. We would like to know about it and do life with you. Amen and Amen. So we just like to thank God for this word that we've received today. We'd like to thank our pastor. Thank you so much, Reverend, for that wonderful word. And we'd also like to draw your attention to just a few announcements. This week, we continue with Faith Time, and we started a very wonderful topic about the Holy Spirit. And we encourage you to just be a part of those nice and wonderful studies. They happen on Wednesdays, every Wednesday, 7 p.m. If you'd like to join in person, or if you would like to join via Zoom, feel free to jump in at 7:30. Amen. And also, we'd like to thank everyone who gives to the work of the Lord Jesus Christ here at CFGM. And we invite all of you to just be a part of this wonderful and noble cause. Amen. So we just encourage you to just jump on our website. You'll find details of how you could give financially or how you can get involved with everything that we're doing here at CFGM. We love you, and we're just so grateful for you. And we're going to finish in a song of worship. Amen. So let's sing together that song. Thank you for the way you love us. Amen.
Thank you for the way.
Love you, church. Have a wonderful week, and we'll see you on Wednesday.
Amen.